This is the wheat belt of southwest Australia. Before this part of the continent was settled by Europeans, it was occupied by a large and varied selection of strange marsupial animals. As the European settlers began to clear the land and introduced new species, the native animals began to disappear. One new predator, which was brought to Australia, turned out to have an even more devastating effect on the remaining marsupials. In many parts of Australia, some native species have already died out. But in the southwest, it's been discovered that many of the surviving marsupials have a strange ally in their fight against extinction. A family of plants, which has provided them with a deadly form of protection. Australia has long been regarded as a continent of curious creatures. The first Europeans to arrive here were totally unfamiliar with the great diversity of strange creatures they met. The early settlers had many hardships to contend with, including fire and drought. Many of the native marsupials occurred in such abundance that they too added to the settlers' tribulations with their nocturnal activities. Burrowing betongs, known locally as boodies, supplement their diet of fungi, bulbs and seeds with almost anything edible they come across. Tough and resourceful as they were, the settlers were sometimes driven to distraction by the boodies' nightly invasions of their camps. When the settlers first arrived, burrowing betongs were among the most common animals in this new continent. Yet today, less than two centuries later, they're extinct in mainland Australia. Many of southwest Australia's other marsupials have suffered a similar fate. The western barred bandicoot used to be common in drier areas of the southwest. It feeds on insects, small lizards and tubers. But both western barred bandicoot and burrowing betong are now confined to a few small islands off the western Australian coast. The driest parts of southwest Australia were also once the home of an even more bizarre creature. The bilby must rank as one of the strangest animals in this continent of curiosities. Once common in the wheat belt, today bilbies only exist in Australia's arid interior. But while land clearance reduced the available areas left to all these animals, the mystery remained as to why they have all but vanished in the last 100 years. On the mainland, the disappearance of many species has been almost total, yet they still survive on islands. 100 years before Captain Cook, Dutch explorers reached an island off Western Australia and found it overrun by rat-like animals the size of cats. They called it Rotnest, or Rat's Nest Island. What they mistook for rats were quokkas, a species of small wallaby, the first marsupials ever seen by Europeans. Today, quokkas are as abundant on Rotnest Island as when it was discovered by the Dutch. The explorers who first saw them must have thought they were strange little animals indeed when they stood up on their hind legs and bounded off through the grasses. Quokkas are a major tourist attraction on Rotnest Island because on the mainland they've almost disappeared, like most of the southwest's marsupial species. Today, Rotnest's quokkas are virtually the only medium-sized marsupials West Australians are familiar with. This sudden and rapid decline of native species on the Australian mainland was puzzling. For some blocks of their original habitat still remain, yet the animals were vanishing here too. It's only after dark that the creatures in the remaining Jarrah forest, which still border the wheat belt, come to life. There are no really large predators in Australia's forests, but hunters come in many shapes and sizes. The western quoll, also known by its Aboriginal name as the chuditch, is the largest predator in the forest. The carnivorous quoll eats almost anything it can catch, on the ground or in the trees. The arrival of Europeans spelt trouble for the quolls. They quickly learned that where people settled, there was food to be found among their rubbish. But these versatile predators also quickly learned to become chicken thieves. As a result, many were killed, and the surviving quolls are now confined to the depths of the Jarrah forest. But few people noticed the decline of so many of the smaller marsupials. One who did was Per Christensen. As a young forest officer in the 1970s, he studied a pocket of survivors in Perup Forest, where several species were still common. Little research had been done on these animals, and their behavior was largely unknown. One animal Per Christensen studied was another species of betong, the brush-tailed. Locally, they're called woylies. Unlike the more social burrowing betong, woylies are noisy and quarrelsome creatures. Found that the woylies played an important part in the ecology of the forest. Their main diet is fungi, which grow underground. Woylies have strong claws for digging through the hard-packed soil. They sniff out the fungi, like truffle hounds. The fungal spores then pass through their gut into their droppings and are eventually buried with their own ready-made fertilizer by dung beetles. The spores eventually germinate underground, producing more fungi for the woylies to eat. But no sooner had Per begun to unravel the ecology of Perup Forest than here, too, the animals started disappearing. Then he made another, more sinister discovery. Foxes were introduced from Europe last century, and so were rabbits. Rabbits can breed 10 times faster than Australian marsupials, and they spread quickly across Australia because the dry climate suited them. There were soon so many rabbits that foxes ceased to have an effect on their numbers. But for the native animals, an ecological disaster was unfolding, for they couldn't withstand attack from foxes. In the face of this fresh onslaught, populations of the small and medium-sized marsupials plunged even further. Yet initially, few scientists were willing to accept Per Christensen's theory that the fox was to blame. But at about the same time, another remarkable biological relationship was being unraveled. Gastrolobium, or poison plants, are members of the pea family, with around 40 species confined almost exclusively to southwestern Australia. They're now known to produce a highly toxic substance, but the early settlers were unaware of this and couldn't understand why their precious livestock often died soon after arrival in the country. The poison the plants produce is most concentrated in the parts which animals feed on, such as the growing tips, seeds and flowers. And the poison is deadly to any introduced species of animals which ingest it. But it's an entirely different story for many of Southwest Australia's native animals. Over millions of years, they've evolved tolerance to the poison from gastrolobiums, and to species such as the emu, they're now quite harmless. Over countless generations, Southwest Australia's native animals and poison plants have been engaged in a form of biological warfare. The plants steadily produced increasing amounts of poison to deter animals from eating them, while the animals responded by developing higher levels of immunity. The discovery of this extraordinary relationship between the native animals and the poison plants was crucial to their future. For the substance produced by gastrolobiums is exactly the same as 1080 poison, which was already being manufactured commercially in Australia to control rabbits. And it was already becoming clear that despite the foxes, in forests like Perup, with its high density of poison plants, the native animals were able to hang on longer. In places like this, foxes could eventually die through eating marsupials, which themselves had been feeding on poison plants. To an extent, this held fox numbers in check. Once it was known that native species in the southwest were immune to the effects of 1080, it could also be used in the war against introduced predators like the fox. But one of the first species to benefit from this breakthrough was not a forest dweller. Dotted across the landscape of the Australian wheat belt are rocky outcrops of granite. They're the home of another of southwest Australia's threatened species, the black-footed rock wallaby. Rock wallabies have granulated soles on their feet to provide extra grip on the rock surfaces as they leap about. Jack Kinnear is a scientist working for the Department of Conservation and Land Management. He began his study of rock wallabies 20 years ago when they'd already become extinct in many areas. Adult males are usually the most dominant individuals in the colony. Much of their time is spent testing the receptiveness of the females. They stay close to any which shows signs of estrus. Another adult male is attracted to the mating pair. The dominant male is caught on the hop and he's in no position to fight back. Aware of this, the second male tries to displace his rival. Jack found that even among the surviving groups of rock wallabies, numbers were continuing to dwindle. He was determined to find the cause before it was too late. Jack's help, would the rock wallabies survive, or would they join the list of species which had already disappeared completely? In southwest Australia, poison baiting schemes are now routinely used in the war to control foxes. But when Jack Kinnear first noticed the decline in rock wallaby populations 20 years ago, the idea that foxes could be responsible was still a new one. Jack found that poisoning was the only effective way to eliminate foxes, and their control had to be continuous, for as fast as resident foxes were killed, others moved in to take their place. But eventually, he found that where fox control was carried out, the rock wallabies recovered, while elsewhere they died out. The key was the survival rate of the young. A baby rock wallaby remains inside its mother's pouch for over 7 months. During this time, it begins exploring the outside world and nibbling solid food. This baby's first real excursion takes place in a sheltered cave. But it's keen to return to the safety of its mother's pouch again. Today, numbers are higher than they've been for 50 years, because there are now many independent young, which the foxes used to prey on after they'd left their mother's pouches. In future, rock wallabies may be reintroduced to other sites where they've died out, now that foxes are being controlled effectively. To the southwest of the wheat belt lies a vast swathe of Jarrah forest, which has become the last refuge for the western quoll. The streams and creeks provide rich hunting for the quolls which are left. Although there are fewer foxes here than in the farmlands, their impact has been just as serious. Now this intruder poses a double threat to the remaining quolls. It competes with them for food, since both species have a similar diet. And the quoll's position as the top predator has been usurped, as the hunter becomes the hunted. To try and save the last of the native fauna, the scientists from the Department of Conservation and Land Management extended their fox baiting schemes to the air. Dried meat, dosed with 1080 poison, is dropped from the aircraft into the surrounding countryside. This method isn't possible elsewhere in Australia because the wildlife doesn't have the same inbuilt immunity to 1080. Once foxes have been reduced, the balance tips in favor of the marsupials, which start to recover again. Poison plants have also helped the wildlife in another way. Wherever the plants grew very densely, the settlers often didn't bother to clear the land. Today, many of these areas have been turned into national parks. Dryandra Forest is one of the last homes of this dainty little creature, the numbat. In the early 1960s, Western Australia chose the numbat as its emblem, only to have scientists discover a few years later that numbats were almost extinct. Unlike most marsupials, numbats are active during the day. They feed almost exclusively on termites. As a result, their teeth have become reduced to little pegs. The numbat uses its cylindrical tongue to extract up to 20,000 termites a day from tunnels radiating from their nests. The echidna, or spiny anteater, is another termite feeder living in these forests. It breaks open the termite nests with its strong clawed feet and then uses its long tongue, which is coated with sticky saliva, to reach deep into the galleries to extract the termites. When an echidna is feeding, it also swallows a considerable amount of soil and nest material, as well as termites. Unlike the numbat, the echidna doesn't have any teeth at all. Fox control has paid dividends in Dryandra Forest too. Department of Conservation and Land Management scientist Tony Friend and his team have been able to monitor a thriving population of numbats where 20 years ago they were on the verge of extinction. Numbats reproduce in a remarkable way. These tiny 6-week-old young were born after a pregnancy of just 14 days. The female numbat doesn't have a pouch. The young are simply clamped by mouth to her 4 teats, which are protected by her belly hair. The mother has a new radio transmitter fitted. The status of numbats needed monitoring, as plans were being made to release them back into areas where the numbers of foxes had already been brought under control. Several months later, and the 4 embryonic babies have developed into a brood of healthy young numbats. They're close to independence and are now feeding on termites like their mother. But supplies around their nest hole have almost run out, and the female needs to move her young to another part of her territory. The family waits until the sun has warmed the forest floor and the termites have become active before they prepare to leave. There's a certain amount of indecision about just which direction they should take. But some of the young are impatient to start feeding. One baby is less advanced and more reluctant to leave the safety of the nest. So the female returns to offer a little support. Riding piggyback is a typical form of numbat transport. The other young have already started to practice their nest building skills. Numbats are defenseless little animals. They rely on their keen eyesight and hearing to alert them to danger, while their only means of escape is to hide in hollow trees. As the forest warms up, a carpet python, hungry after its winter hibernation, becomes active. Strategy is to enter hollow logs where it can smell numbats and then play a waiting game. If there's a numbat already inside, or one bolts into the same hole, the python's dinner is served with minimum effort. In the evening, the numbat leads her family to a fresh sleeping nest. She arrives with her most dependent offspring back on board. Soon, another of the young joins her. And then a third. Finally, the family is complete again, and this time, none fell victim to the snake. Over millions of years of defensive strategy, the gastrolobium plants have produced increased levels of poison. But some animals, like ants, have never acquired a tolerance to it. Instead, they've developed an association with another species which can gain nourishment directly from the poison plants, the caterpillar of a type of blue butterfly. This species of caterpillar produces a non-poisonous secretion from glands on its head, which the ants feed on. In return, the caterpillar benefits from the ants, which guard it from attack by a species of parasitic wasp. Some animals acquire their own form of indirect immunity to the poison. The red-tailed fascagale is now confined to just a couple of forests in the wheat belt. It feeds on insects, which themselves may have been feeding on poison plants, but the fascagale is able to cope with the small amounts of poison they contain. Fascagales feed almost exclusively on the ground, but they spend a lot of time in the forest canopy too. Red-tailed fascagales breed during the Australian winter. After mating, the males rapidly disappear. It seems they die from high stress levels created by their breeding activities. This system leaves more food available for the females to rear their large litters of 6 to 8 young. The males from these broods will father the next generation before they too die off. The poison plants also have a special strategy for reproducing themselves. In late summer, their seeds ripen and begin to fall to the ground. poison-tolerant species, like the bronze-winged pigeon, find the seeds very tasty and make use of the harvest with impunity. The seeds are poisonous to ants, but each has a fleshy outgrowth attached to it, which is non-poisonous and attractive to them. It's a form of bribe, encouraging the ants to transport the seeds away to their nests underground. Many of them then lie forgotten until fire engulfs the forest and intense heat stimulates their germination. But while the seeds lie safely underground, what will happen to the animals when fire sweeps through the forest? In southwest Australia, bushfires occur at irregular intervals, but the native animals are nevertheless well adapted to them. A brush-tailed bettong may experience a fire only once in its lifetime, yet it takes it in its stride. It moves ahead of the fire, and then at the first opportunity, doubles back into its territory again. Its main food, underground fungi, will still survive under the burnt ground after the fire has passed. It's not only the marsupials, but some of Australia's birds too, which have suffered the disastrous effects of fox predation. Before the land was cleared, it contained vast tracts of scrub called mallee. The mallee fowl is a species of bush turkey. It feeds on insects, shoots and seeds, including those of the poisonous gastrolobiums, which also grow in mallee scrub. Today, only fragments of mallee scrub remain, and as the birds can only fly short distances, they're now marooned in them. Foxes are everywhere here too, and the mallee fowl have declined drastically as a result. In 1991, a group of farmers got together to save the few remaining mallee fowl in the southwest. One was Kelly O'Neill. He continues to wage war on foxes. As a result, this small patch of bush has a higher density of mallee fowl than anywhere else in Australia. The huge mound is a mallee fowl's nest. The presence of poison plants in this block also helps the mallee fowl. It's been fenced to keep out sheep, providing ideal conditions for the birds. The mallee scrub also contains a thick layer of accumulated litter, which the birds use to build up their enormous nest mounds, which act as giant incubators. Mallee fowl are megapodes, which means big feet. The mallee fowl needs its big feet to build its extraordinary nest. Cockbird calls to his hen, inviting her to come and join in the work too. Using their strong toes to scratch up the litter, the birds build up the mound until it's several meters high. Here, the eggs will be laid and left to hatch by themselves. The birds toil for many hours under the hot sun, shifting tons of nest material until the structure is exactly to their liking. Before the eggs are laid, the male tests the temperature of the mound by taking a bill full of sand, which then comes into contact with heat receptors inside its upper mandible. Up to 20 eggs are laid, each one at intervals of a week. Each egg takes 7 weeks to hatch. The enormous pile of rotting compost generates much of the required heat. Later, the sun takes over. The birds open or close up the mound depending on the outside conditions. Deep inside, a constant temperature is maintained in order to incubate the eggs. But nowadays, the mallee fowl's highly efficient incubator faces a problem it was never designed for. The fox's keen sense of smell helps it to find the mallee fowl's buried eggs. Foxes also catch the adult birds too, when they're engrossed in working on their mounds. But the fox's liking for eggs can also prove to be their undoing. Domestic hens' eggs injected with 1080 poison and then buried also prove irresistible to them. It may be the last time this fox goes hunting for eggs. The Mallee Fowl Protection Group has already had considerable success in controlling foxes. Despite the grim picture of fox predation and loss of habitat on Southwest Australia's wildlife, it's not all bad news. Surprises still sometimes occur. At Two Peoples Bay on the southern coast, a small tract of coastal heath and scrub was set aside as a wildlife reserve in the early 1960s. The sanctuary owes its existence to one remarkable bird species which was rediscovered here after it had been thought extinct for over 50 years. The noisy scrub bird is small and solidly built, but can fly only short distances. It probably survived here in gullies where fire couldn't penetrate, though its population may have dipped to as few as 50 individuals before its rediscovery. The reserve at Two Peoples Bay is also one of the few places where quokkas, which thrive on Rottnest Island, still survive on the Australian mainland. But here they're much more secretive. In 1994, Dr. Liz Sinclair was studying quokkas here to investigate how they differed from the ones on Rottnest Island. Live traps, in which the animals could be caught unharmed, were set each evening to coincide with their main period of activity. The quokkas proved remarkably difficult to catch, and for over a week the traps remained empty. Finally, one morning, there was an animal in one of the traps. But it wasn't a quokka, or any other species Liz was familiar with. Its discovery created great excitement, for it was later identified as a Gilbert's potoroo, another supposedly extinct species, and one which hadn't been seen for 125 years. Gilbert's potoroo used to live alongside the more common quokka in this part of southwest Australia. Like the noisy scrub bird, its continued existence at Two People's Bay is probably due to the fire-resistant gullies it lives in among the granite outcrops. In 1988, fox control had been started in the reserve, and that may also have helped the potoroo survive. But the known population is still tiny, around 20 animals. So Gilbert's potoroo still needs all the protection it can be given. Even with such encouraging signs, the future for many of Southwest Australia's native animals still remains in the balance. Despite the extensive baiting programs, foxes haven't been eliminated, just reduced. But research into a new form of biological control, sterilization, is making headway. If successful, it could eventually eradicate this major pest from Australia altogether. But with less foxes, many marsupials are already making a comeback. Some, like the western quoll and the numbat, are also being reintroduced into areas which are now virtually fox-free. And for the very first time, a species has been removed from Australia's long list of endangered animals. For the brush-tailed bettong has increased so successfully, it's no longer considered rare. But now there may be new additions to the list of Australia's threatened species. For at least half a dozen of the same gastrolobium plants which have helped the native wildlife to survive are now themselves extremely rare. The poison plants certainly warrant saving. For without the help of their deadly protection, when they were at their lowest ebb, many of Southwest Australia's animals would never have had the chance to bounce back from the shadow of extinction.